It's a real pleasure to welcome our next speaker, Dr. John Tsai. John is the Chief Medical Officer of Novartis, a vastly experienced and thoughtful drug developer, and my beloved partner in R&D. Experienced in all phases of innovative medicines development, John and his GDD organization that leads our intergalactic confirmatory phase clinical trials lean heavily on a new and digital infrastructure throughout the regional challenges of the pandemic. So we welcome John to share these learnings with this community of drug hunters, as well as, John, your reflections on pandemic preparedness. Thank you for staying with us late on a Basel Tuesday, and welcome.
Yeah, thanks, Jay. Thanks for the invitation. It's great to be here to the first NIBR Science of Therapeutics Symposium. And I've been paying attention to all of the presentations thus far. It's been really fun to dive deep into learnings about the coronavirus and therapeutic options as we've been exploring. So maybe to give a little bit of background over the next 10 minutes, what I was planning on doing was to take a step back and walk you through the development approach and how we look at it from a clinical trials perspective of what we've seen during COVID-19 over the past 18 months or so. So a slight digression from what you guys have seen so far, but maybe through the lens of a drug developer of what has been experienced overall as the approach that we've taken. Maybe what I'll do here is ask everyone to take a step back and think back 18 months ago when the pandemic started to happen. We saw some of the complexities and considerations. And as you know, the novel coronavirus started to hit first in China, obviously, and started to roll transmission in the other parts of the world, first hitting parts of Europe and southern Italy, then moving north from Italy into other parts of Europe, and then finally hitting the United States. We saw that there was a big wave of considerations in terms of therapeutics, diagnostics, in terms of solutions and what we were thinking about, and a lot of people wanting to jump in to help. So what I want to do is outline some of those challenges that we saw from a drug developer's lens, how we came up with some solutions, and how we actually can better prepare next time. Hopefully there won't be a next time, but if there is a next time that we're fully prepared, also potentially for learnings as we approach thinking about the way that we actually do drug development. So let me go to the first slide here, and if I could find the first slide here as we move forward. So as we think about the first step that we took was prioritization, and I'll highlight three different topics here for us to think about in terms of overall drug development, which is prioritization. So I took you back during those 18 months. What you saw was everybody wanted to jump in and help. So there were pharmaceutical companies that had antivirals, maybe parasitic agents, anti-inflammatories, anti-anything, and everyone wanted to do a study. There was also academic institutions. And I remember when I was here that I was receiving emails from all kinds of different academicians and scientists who said, hey, what about that anti-inflammatory agent that you guys have? So would you be willing to actually try this during COVID? Then we also had the government agencies wanting to jump in. What we had was everyone diving in at the same time. And if you fast forward and you just look at what we have currently at the beginning of June, we have over 6,000 clinical trials, in fact, on clinicaltrials.gov with a handful of agents that were experimenting. And I remember those early days where we actually saw the first report out of the hydroxychloroquine, which was an outcomes study that said that potentially hydroxychloroquine could have an effect on COVID-19. What happened was we jumped right in and said, hey, we want to be able to provide and test to see if we can get a clinical trial up and started during that time. And in fact, when we actually got that study started in about 6 weeks' time, which is record time for us, in fact, we saw that there were already 50 trials in place for hydroxychloroquine. Many of those were not placebo-controlled, well-designed studies. And in fact, ours was the only one. But given the, all of the individuals and all the teams that wanted to dive in, what we saw was, in fact, that we were overwhelmed and academic institutions were overwhelmed because it was very difficult to prioritize not only just the single agent hydroxychloroquine, but all of the agents that were available and out there. So I think what this requires as we think about the next step is we require, and it would be great to have an infrastructure with equal partnership between academia, industry, and governments, not only about prioritizing the agents, but also once those results come out, how we can share those results and have a common protocol on the approach. So that's one consideration as we move forward. Let's jump to the second consideration in terms of what we think about when we are talking about the challenges of COVID-19 and clinical studies. And this is really around clarity and agility as we conduct these clinical studies. Throughout 2020, when we were conducting these trials, it felt like we were operating completely in the dark. What we saw was that the pandemic was actually impacting countries and regions in waves. When you saw that there was a wave actually in southern part of Europe, what we would do is we had one study up and running. And when we actually got the sites up and running, we would actually try to recruit patients from those countries, whether that was southern Europe or in the United States. When there was a big wave coming in, what would happen is that the hospitals were overwhelmed. They were overwhelmed in ensuring that they were taking care of patients. And by the time they actually had time to recruit patients in the clinical studies, we would hit a nadir and it would be very difficult to actually recruit patients at that point. So we were hitting different peaks and troughs and we were chasing pandemics around the world and chasing patients around the world and having little success in terms of recruitment. So that's probably the second challenge that we saw. And the opportunity that we see there is having a global clinical network to ensure that we have real-time epidemiologic intelligence to know where the next peak might occur and also have insights on how we can ensure that we stay one step ahead of the pandemic so we could recruit patients. Maybe let's think about a third opportunity for us and a potential third challenge. And the third challenge is really coordination with the regulatory authorities. What you see, obviously, in the last description that I gave was that we are ensuring, and I want to make sure that we're on the right slide here. Yeah, coordination. And as we're actually working with different health authorities in different countries around the world, we want to get feedback so that we can get our clinical studies off the ground. But what you ended up seeing was what we would submit the common protocol to the US FDA, EMA, and some of the other countries, but we would actually get feedback and have to make amendments at different times, and different countries would give us different pieces of feedback, therefore ensuring that we had to have different amendments for different countries. You could see the challenge there would be that we would have different protocols, whether that would be one for the US, one for Spain. And I think what that really requires is a coordinated global health authority feedback so that we can ensure that it's consistent across all the countries. So we wouldn't have 15 different amendments and have to make these trade-offs. Now, if you think back to a year and a half ago, 4 weeks seemed like it was a year. So if we could actually have one common protocol across all of the countries and a consistent feedback from the health authorities, that would allow us to get the protocol off the ground quickly in a matter of 2 or 4 weeks, and we could begin recruiting patients and ensure that we can have a potential solution for COVID-19. All this being said, you could see that I've summarized the three different approaches that could be in as we think about considerations and the challenges that we encountered during the COVID-19 pandemic. What might be some solutions? And we've been having these discussions with the various health authority agencies, with various academic institutions, and collaborating within the pharmaceutical companies so that we can come together as a potential approach moving forward. So hopefully that gave you some insights into the overall drug development and clinical trials world. I'm hopeful and I hope that there isn't a next pandemic, but if there is, I think we're going to be ready and much more prepared as we look forward and ensure that we work very closely together in terms of collaborating and having insights on how to deal with the future. So it's great what we're doing today, getting together, getting the scientific community together to learn a lot more about COVID-19 and how we move forward. So I wish you a great rest of the event. And with that, I'd like to turn it over to Jennifer Leeds for the next session. So over to you, Jennifer.